Welcome back to the open road. And before we start, we'll do a quick recap. The journey thus far, we were only still at base camp, so we haven't really departed yet. And base camp is where we'll get to know each other and prepare for the journey. So yeah, just to do a quick recap. So the open road is where we kind of learn together. We go through various plays, interactive ways of learning using a virtual board. We're using Miro for that. This is a public open event, but I hope that doesn't limit us from still creating that wonderful environment that we also kind of experience when we just have a little travel hub, which isn't broadcasted. So yeah, everyone can get like a feeling of the vibe that we get going. Shall we pass a magic item again? If that works. So let's see. I've got something new on my desk. It's these little fishies, little aquarium. So I'm gonna magically transform this into something and pass it to Demerson. You weren't here last time, so you won't know. But what would you like to know, Demerson, about what we covered last time?
If you could summarize the last experience in one sentence, how would you do it? And I'm asking Vaishali.
Oh, I have my magic object this time, but it's over here. 1 second, can I get it? See, look. Amazing. What was it? Transformize? One sentence. Oh, that's really hard, Demerson. What a challenge. I think last time just really enjoyed getting to know everyone and learning a little bit more about how we were going to travel with each other. So we kind of set the foundation and table. I'll pass this to Scott so he can build on my sentence if I left anything out.
Yeah, my magic object is interesting. It's I bought it off Amazon Impulse Buy, and it's a box of cards of icebreakers. I mistakenly bought deep icebreakers. They're a bit too much. I'll give you an example. What event in your past are you too scared to talk about? Ooh. So, you know, You probably should have been with your team, your group for a while. If you go in that avenue, it's a bit different from like, what was the band you liked growing up? You know, it's a bit different. So that's my magic object. But I was feeling a little bit brain dead. So I felt good for Vaishali refreshing my memory. But yeah, things that come into mind are like, yes, how we're setting ourselves up to travel together. It almost like some voyaging into some kind of contracting and what we might expect. I'll pass my magic item to Ray.
Use my Apple earpod case, because you know Apple is big on the word magic. You know, that's just kind of how I think. But I just came back from a leadership conference, and one of the things I got from over there for participating in it is a challenge coin, which is probably getting blurred. But challenge coins are kind of an old military tradition. A lot of organizations have started adapting it. You know, it's an old tradition. You know, usually you would get a challenge coin for accomplishing something. Like if the first challenge coin I got was because I had completed 10 consecutive weeks of 10-mile runs with the chaplain when I was in training in Arizona way back forever ago. And we got, you know, battalion challenge coin for that. And, you know, they're a physical token of an accomplishment. And it was definitely a very informative, you know, challenging session. Yeah. So last session was pretty broken for me, because I had a breakout kind of in the middle. I joined and then missed the first part and had a breakout. We went through I was here for the clean setup portion and, brought in my usual Bruce Lee reference and be like water. I'm just making that continued connection between, you know, agility and flow.
Yeah, and it's a good kind of build up to where we're going next, because we kind of ended at the coaching arc, and it begins with establishing the environment. So we want to establish a psychologically safe environment where everybody feels comfortable, getting outside of their comfort zones a little bit. But also to have a good frame of what we're going to do and how we're going to do it, what are our expectations. So there's already a couple of plays we introduced for that. So we did the guidelines. So we did the secret messages so everybody could teach back the rules that we have on this journey. But also we went through clean setup. So what are your expectations and what would this journey be like for you? What would you need? What would you like to achieve before the end? We did like a chalk and talk with the chalkboard. We're going to continue today, kind of going through this arc as well, and to find out what your challenges are, to explore those actively by listening actively, by asking powerful questions, by capturing, detecting some generalizations, some limiting beliefs. So I like to refer to them as closed doors. So how can we open them? How would you want to go down this scary cliff? What's still troubling us? And you know, we want to go down there, that cliff, safely. And of course, acknowledge the experience. So that's what this is going to be like. The coaching arc, you can use this, of course, in individual coaching, but we're also coaching groups. We're coaching each other. This is good to kind of keep this in mind. Like if you're coaching someone, you're going through a journey together, and you need, you know, it's good to be shoulder to shoulder, so to speak. It's very cliche, but they say, you know, meet them where they're at. Do we have any, do you want to comment a little bit or discuss this coaching arc a little bit? Is this something you also use in practice or something along those lines? What's your coaching journey like? Do you recognize some of the destinations? Is it missing anything?
On the meet them where they're at thing, I'm exploring that, you know, and the speed they're going, you know, shared understanding and what the goals are, and not velocity in terms of the misuse of story pointing, but like the velocity of like how fast they actually want to do something different or work towards the goals, you know, just really exploring that. It's not simple, you know, every time you think you know where something is, it's not, you know, exploring it further. So it always makes me think of like, it's maybe even becoming cliche of meeting them where they are, but it's such an interesting thing to remember, to really look into.
It's meet them where they are, but can you also be okay with where they are?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
And Emerson?
Something that ties to what Scott just said and speaks really, really strongly to me is the objective. It can be any objective, but once you establish that, it's really important not to lose focus. Because then if you just wander around, you are wasting time from both yourself and the person being coached. So it really is something that I like to keep in mind.
Be really clear on what your shared purpose is, right? So it's something you both want to achieve. Yeah, well, maybe the topic for today, maybe different tomorrow, right? That's also a challenge. So how to kind of stay focused when you're coaching someone. Do you also remember maybe a situation where that was a particular challenge to you, Emerson?
Yes. I mean, not anything too big, but it's always challenging to keep the agenda and instead of stray away from it. It's because you are coaching someone and connecting at a personal level, it's usually easy to talk about just anything. But as a coach, keeping in mind that you do have an objective, you do want to reach a goal, is challenging at times. And I mean, that's my personal struggle. I have to keep watching myself not to just wander.
Mm. Yeah, because there's many rabbit holes to go down.
Easily.
I think, Matt, you also raised your hand. So how do you set up a good base camp for Scrum so that people in the team and in your organization, that they know why are we going to do Scrum? Why now? What will be expected of me? What can I expect from my organization? What might change? What will happen if we get challenged? Will it all be worth it? These kind of questions maybe on people's minds. If you don't check them off, you will meet resistance. Because Scrum introduces stress into the organization. And knowing that you have a good support structure in place for everybody in case you get challenged with that. So that's a huge challenge for Scrum Masters, I think. It's been one thing that's just preoccupied me for years. So I want to kind of check with you, how are you establishing your metaphorical base camp for Scrum? How do you foster this environment to create these conditions where Scrum can really thrive? Because it's not just about the mechanics of Scrum. It's maybe the mushy wushy part. We'll get intimate really quickly again. We're gonna huddle up and share a tent, pair and share. So if you meet me on the board here, you should be able to find your token over there.
So what do we need to establish Basecamp? An environment for self-management to thrive. So interestingly, I always, especially when you've got a new gig, you're like, well, I've learned from last time, I need to do this to start with. And I saw, Becky, that you might be heading to a new gig. So what are you going to do first?
Hide in the corner.
Yeah.
I suppose, no, I mean, the first thing I would do is nothing, to be honest.
Yeah.
Because, I mean, as mentioned earlier, meeting them where they are, I wouldn't do anything at all. I think the most important thing is to build that trust and an environment where people feel safe. I think if you go in and focus especially on processes and tools and ways of working, I think it's too much. And I think that the most important thing, as Sjord said earlier, is the values and the pillars, and those things are the things that are really important. Mm-hmm. So I would focus on those, but after a period of time, not immediately.
And I can really remember very well that, when you set out with that intention in mind, it can still be very tempting to want to show your worth, to kind of earn your spot, so to speak. They come up with all these opportunities for improvement. And of course, yourself, you notice, you get your situational awareness, you know what's going on, you want to kind of show that you can be of value in these ways. So it's really tempting to start improving things, or focusing on improvement really quickly.
We're also quite often, as a Scrum Master, quite often brought in to solve a problem. So they want it solved immediately.
And that problem commonly is superficial, right? Go faster, or a version or cousin of that, right? It's never something deeper. And then, as we explore the environment, right, we realize, okay, you could go, there maybe is a simple answer to go faster, but what do you want to change?
Yeah, maybe you need to slow down first.
Exactly. What would you, if you don't want to change anything, how could you go faster? Also, you know what I mean? Like explore the environment, see what's going on. I always think of that quote, I'll butcher it, you know, when a flower doesn't grow, don't blame the flower, blame the environment. So in that meeting them where they are, you know, often we're thrust into a team, you know, Scott, right, you're joining the banana team. So you come and, you can help us do this. And there's always weird stuff, right, which is, you know, that's fine. That's cool. But then you explore the environment as well, right, because teams have their own little problems, but usually it's a symptom of something else that's going on. So you try and explore, don't you, and see what's going on. It's fascinating and complex, isn't it, outside the team?
Yeah. It's also interesting that there's, like you mentioned, there's weird stuff. And, obvious, of course, when you're new and joining. It's maybe even obvious to people who already work there, but they, you know, they've accepted the situation to be normal.
And it could just be, like, annoying if you point it out to the team, because they're well aware it's this peculiar thing, but they've just got used to it and gone, all right, there's bigger fish to fry, and you haven't seen the bigger fish, right? So you might point something strange out, and, like, everyone just gets annoyed at you, and it doesn't help anyone. You know, so like Becky said, do nothing
for a little while.
And that's why I mentioned the speed as well, because, like, you know, a little startup with 20 people, you know, one Scrum team is different to an enterprise, you know, maybe a big bank or something. So, like, the speed of the length of you do nothing might be different in those two places, you know?
Yeah. I think Becky mentioned also, it's like doing nothing, but you're also doing something very profound. And I think Becky mentioned something along the lines of building that trust, foundation. So also really learning about, you know, not it's not about you, but it's about them, finding out who the persons, the individuals you're going to work with, and what's keeping them awake at night, and what's on their minds, and what do they like, and, you know, what's their experience with the work that they do. It's good to start learning that first. Just show your curiosity. I'm you know, curious, Becky. Anything? Do you have anything particular in mind as to how you want to kind of create opportunities for that? Because everybody's busy schedules, busy meetings.
I actually don't have a plan. Which
good.
Is okay.
It's good. Yeah.
I thought I should have a plan, and then I thought, no.
I bet you used to have a plan, right? And you've let go of that, yeah.
Yeah, no, I've realised that, as everybody who works in an agile environment knows, plans are just pointless.
Yeah.
Because it won't work out the way that I expect it to, and the things that I expect to happen won't happen. So I have my Miro board where I can write things down and explore my thoughts and that sort of thing without imposing them on the team, and I will just collect them over days or maybe even weeks, and then I will look back and see if, so I suppose I have a plan for myself in that I will write these things down so that I can then look back maybe in a couple of weeks and think, is that really what I thought it was?
I think that's important to make that clear as well, because when we say do nothing, we don't literally a little bit of literally do nothing, but you are observing, right? You know, like, oh, you know,
I'm trying to untangle and understand and interpret even just the underlying tones, not just the things that you can see, but the why behind what's happening.
Sometimes I've observed things and then I've, like, deleted my observation because I've gone, I was a bit, you know, it's a bit too early. I didn't have enough data. You know, I didn't see it. It was maybe a strange day. And then after a little bit, kind of you make sure you're being clean about their observations, right? You know, is it the factual thing of what happened, not opinionated or anything? So trying to be clean, and then if there's a place that makes sense, not early, some kind of clean feedback scenario, what I observed is this, what they inferred is there's something else to explore there, what do people do type thing.
You just need that to go in it with an open agenda. And open expectations.
Cool.
I think that's something I can really take away from this.
Yeah, Vishali, I heard the tail end of what you're saying, and that's a great item to have, is imagination. You know, now that we're coming back, I'll toss that one out there. But, you know, can you imagine, like, you know, What do you imagine the journey is going to be? What do you imagine you're going to see on that path?
Sure. Yeah. I was just saying that's one of my favorite things that you say.
All the time. Yeah, I'm going to get into that. So okay, do you mind sharing a key takeaway? Because I think already captured a little one of the takeaway there. But anything else that came out of maybe
the next? Should we start?
Yeah.
So a few things came to our discussion, very rich actually, even though it was like 5 minutes or so. But we ended with language and how language is important to keep people aware of their surroundings and aware of what we think. So things that are as simple as they use a term that is talent manager. So just by changing that slightly and saying it's a talent manager versus anything else like resource manager or anything else already changes the entire mindset behind it and keep people aware of what is important, what is going on. So tiny details, but has a powerful meaning behind.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think in our conversation, Becky had, because she's starting up a new adventure as well. And we're just going to ask her, you know, what's going to be your approach to that? I think Becky had some really profound insights. Do you want to share it again, Becky?
I just said I was going to do nothing.
Yeah.
Yep. And we all agreed.
Yeah, to go into it with an open expectation, open agenda. And, so I think that's for me. It's a really good, very profound thing. Okay, we have our tools, we have our techniques, and we have our skills, but we need to create these opportunities. But yeah, there's no point making an upfront plan for that. Because Becky mentioned it very, truthfully, that you know, it's not going to turn out the way you want it to. The plans will inevitably turn out to be a waste because, you know, it's, your expectations won't be met in that particular way. So, you know, even though we're going to live with an open mind and an open agenda, when we talk about playing the game of Scrum together, we do have to align our personal motivations, our personal ambitions, you know, our own passion for our craft, which is personal, to that whichever is our collective ambition. You know, why are we a team? Why does my job exist here? What's the purpose of our products and how can we tie it into it? And then how does Scrum come into play here? Because, you know, you're in that game. What does it really mean for you to be in that game? So you have these questions on your mind, the prerequisites maybe for change as well.
That what you just said reminded me of what Vaishali said. She opened the chat with establishing not only the expectations, but the rules of the game to everyone in the team. What Scrum is, what it's not, what are the reasons behind everything in Scrum? So it's not, oh, let's have a time box of 15 minutes. There's a reason for that. So establishing that and coming to a consensus is also crucial. And not only for Scrum, for any relationship that we have with other people, especially at work.
Yeah. So you mentioned, you know, establishing this consensus, but you'll counter it for some rejection resistance, and I call them closed doors, and I think you talked about these as well. So yeah, Scrum just won't work here, right? Yeah, that's not for me. So how do we deal with those closed doors? And you mentioned language is important. So, as you know, when we're, you know, establishing our environment, we also, you know, really investigating and, you know, showing curiosity about what are really people passionate about, whether they care about, whether they get upset about, what's getting in their way. You want to be able to detect and pick up on some of these, some of the language they're using, so you can ask the right questions to kind of see if you can open those doors that are closed maybe in their minds. And maybe with a little bit more background to this. So here are three closed doors. One, the door on the left represents universal quantifiers, which is kind of a fancy word, but it really means that, you know, there's nothing more than most. It's very absolute in the way it's stated. Very generalized, it's very broad. So that's the red door. Then we have the green door, which is similar, but it's really about people in general. It's the infamous they, the unspecified they, who are they? They could be also very broad groups of people, like managers or parents or people. So those are very, you're missing maybe the reference, like who are we really talking about here? Is it really that? Is it really generalized? Are we generalizing? Is it really all of them? Are there any exceptions? And then we have limiting beliefs, certain convictions that kind of limit us in our growth.
Sorry to jump in. Do we need to share the screen here?
Oh yeah,
somehow.
I was in the breakout.
Yeah, I was like, is this a new solution to the video?
No. Yeah.
Yeah.
So to the audience, this will now make sense what you're talking about.
Thanks, Scott. Yeah.
So for those watching anyway, you can have the Miro link open as well as you're watching this, because it's also in the comments, and hopefully you also have Miro open. So yeah, these are the closed doors. So my question to you is, you know, which of these statements at the bottom belong to which door? Can you map them and just do a free for all? Just feel free to pick any of them and move them where you want.
I love they. I love they. It's a version of that's just the way it is. That's just the way it is here. Why?
Yeah. The way. What's the way?
What way? For how long? Who decided?
Yeah. Now? Always?
Yeah. Love it.
They always, all the time. They never get it right. Wonderful. And it's frustrating as well, because once you're getting familiar with this these words, you'll pick up on you yourself using them, and then it kind of freezes your mind when you're speaking. Yeah, it's kind of frustrating.
It's incredibly hard to stay clean and keep a shared understanding, and this is some of that stuff, isn't it? It's so hard.
Yeah. So some of kind of we do need, because we have filters, right? We do need to compartmentalize things and generalize things a bit in our minds. That's how we are able to cope with all the complexities in the world. So it's very normal we have these filters, and that we generalize and that we categorize things. And sometimes we, again, you know, sometimes we, who's we? Who's we? All of us. Sometimes, always, never. But we.
Now you're just catching yourself.
Yeah, exactly. Good example.
You won't be able to finish the sentence. But wait, what?
Yeah. So it's yeah, it's difficult to not generalize what you're trying to convey, and you use it to your advantage, because you're going to make it a little bit bigger than it really is, or maybe smaller than it really is, depending on what your aim is or what you'd like the outcome to be. Especially when you're having an argument with someone, you're going to be a bit more hyperbolic in the way you communicate. And it's, you know, it's I would say it's very, very much true to human nature. So somebody in their mind has sometimes where somebody else is talking about all the time. And of course, they won't agree on because it, it's about, you know, do you, but what do you think? In your experience, something may have happened more often than in their experience. So it's very subjective. So yeah, how can we open up these closed doors? That's the question. So a little bit before we do that, so these are just a couple of examples, a few examples that we have here, but this is also a little bit from neuro-linguistic programming, being able to detect, to pick up on these words. There's other forms of other kind of things we can pick up on in language, just the meta model, the meta language. We also have like cause-effect biases. So we're assuming that something always leads to something, or just because this is the case doesn't necessarily mean that will be true. And sometimes people hold the cause and effect in relation to each other. They think, oh, just because he did this, that must mean he thinks that or believes that. When I'm conversing with someone, it's very easy to make interpretations about what someone's saying or doing. And just because somebody does something or says something, does that make my interpretation of that correct? It's a bit vague what I'm saying right now, but we'll get into some concrete examples. So that's where we should move forward. There's a nice story. What's this? Who posted this?
I threw it in. You probably remember it. I've probably heard it before. John shared it a million times. Let's not read it out, but it's a story of maybe something's good, maybe something's bad, yeah. Maybe. Just depends.
So can we try and like, if you can catch our highlighter here, in the Miro menu, you have the marker and you can pick up the highlighter and you can, so we can add, you know, what's kind of vague or unspecified or what's maybe generalized here, and you can mark it. So once upon a time, so you could follow this up with a question like, okay, when exactly was that? Was it just once?
Yeah. Oh yeah, literally. Everyone in the street, everyone in the area.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. The story is good in two ways. In itself, it's worth a good. It has a really nice moral to it. A lesson. Yeah. So now we're detecting. We're picking up on some of these. Some of the generalizations. So we can follow them up with a question so that we can make it a little bit more specific. So, but how can we open closed doors? That's one of the fundamental questions, I think, that's on our minds as coaches, as Scrum Masters, maybe as human beings in general. We have certain convictions that limit us in our growth. And sometimes for good reason, we have natural resistors built into us, and that protects us, keeps us safe, and keeps us sane. But they can also be limiting us. So I already heard a couple of prompts that you shared already, but let's see if you can list a couple of prompts here. How would you open closed doors? Let's imagine you're in a conversation with someone and they're saying it never works here. How might you open up these closed doors? All managers are evil.
What does work here?
Yeah,
that does work. Yeah, so
I think just powerful questions like that are super helpful. Mm-hmm. Maybe even just like an open-ended question, like what is missing, or why.
Mm-hmm. So let's imagine we have this particular scenario. This is Oh, I spit the other one. that it won't. It's more Scrum related. So this is Scrum implementations fail all the time. Scrum sounds good in theory, but in practice, that will never work here. The developers are not mature enough to manage all the work by themselves, and management will never let go. So how might we respond to such, you know, this literally almost feels like a door slamming in your face, right? Feels all the time. Sounds good in theory. We'll never work here. They're not mature enough. I'll never let go. Don't even try and enter, right? It's a big red warning sign. Do not cross.
And this is common, right? This is a common scenario. Absolutely. And this is where they are. So when you say meet them where they are, this is where they are. So empathize with that. Maybe even agree. Yeah, okay. Agree. Mm-hmm. What should we do?
They may be right.
Maybe right.
Yeah.
I was just going to say the powerful questions help here, but small experiments would show the facts. Mm. So, of course, we can ask what's missing, what's possible, why that, what does work here. But if you get a smaller team and let them self-manage, and as a result, they do a great job, that fact, the data, the real data will show that maybe it's not as bad as it looks.
Mm-hmm. Gotta try short experiments though, it won't work.
Yeah, so how might we respond to this, like the first sentence, Scrum implementations fail all the time. So we're specifically focused on all the time here.
I would ask them what they mean by all the time.
Mm-hmm. What do you mean by fail as well after that?
That was going to be my question, Scott, is what does fail?
Yeah, what did it look like? What happened? Yeah, what happened? Mm-hmm. And then, like what Demerson was saying, maybe that was the experiment. So, you know, it's, maybe there's something of like what the failure was, and they've not seen there was some learning in there. Yeah. What do you mean by implementation as well? Mm-hmm. Foreseen various forms of that, right?
All right, yeah. That's... Does Scrum really implement? Do you implement a game? You know, it's played or it's practiced. And practice implies that you're getting better at it over time. It doesn't. Scrum is an inactor, right? It doesn't work itself. Right? Chess doesn't play itself. Scrum doesn't play itself.
It might be a bit of an aggressive question. It depends on kind of how the conversation's going, but do you think that, you know, Scrum would be as common and popular as it is if that were the case? Like, Scrum also succeeds a lot of the time. And, you know, what are the reasons for the failures versus the successes?
Absolutely. Yeah. So could you imagine a situation where Scrum does work? You know, maybe not here.
That's forced my hand. I wasn't going to say it. I'd also say, what do you mean by a Scrum? I was trying not to say that, but Ray made me say it. So, yeah, what do we mean? What was implemented before?
Yeah. Yeah, so you can break down pretty much every word in this sentence. And not out of, let's say, you're doing it with the intention to really understand where this is coming from, right? Why this door is closed and why there are locks on it. You know, it's not your intention to come in with a battering ram and smash through the gates, right? Because we may feel like we want to or need to, because this may be very offensive to a Scrum Master whose job it is to make Scrum work, right? And here's someone saying, well, do not enter, right? You don't belong here. Mission will fail you're setting out on your quest and somebody tells you your quest is doomed before you even get started.
I think one of the things to kind of open the door to, because this can be just like, does feel kind of like a shut door, that I've kind of leaned into is like, can you just tell me more? Like, to get them to expand on some of these statements and move away from the generalization. And that's so hard, it is almost hard to do but I feel like just inviting more from them in that moment.
Open-ended questions.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So yeah, when we write like Scrum sounds good in theory, but in practice that will never work here. Like, we know as Scrum Master said, yes, the theory in Scrum is empirical. It's based on practice, right? That's where you emerge from through practice and through, you know, learning by doing. But that may be lost on many who just read, oh yeah, the rules sound good, but it won't work in our situation. And then we also have like, this is for me, the mindset change. It won't work here, or it won't work, or it won't work yet. So that word yet, that at least opens the door a little bit. Like there's a possibility that it will work in the future. It won't work now, given the current situation. And maybe given our past experience, it won't work, but maybe it can work. So what's needed for it to work? So you could ask, what would be needed for Scrum to work, or what would need to change here for Scrum to work, regardless on whether or not that they believe that change to be possible or not. We were almost out of time already because it's only 1 hour. I feel like just getting started.
On that last bit, it's very easy as a bunch of Scrum Masters and Agile coaches to be that granular. That this is when meeting the teams and organizations where they are. Not everybody's as open to actually being questioned. That stuff. So you might have to, you know, what do we mean by all? And that's it for that day. Mm-hmm. You know, and this is like makes me think of Becky, me and Becky talk about doing nothing. That might be a lot, you know. That might be a lot for the day. So it's that mastering the kind of just enough, and then figure it out, peel back the onion and peel it back some more.
Yeah. Peeling the onion. Yeah, we have that as a play as well. Peeling the agile onion, going from, you know, that mindset and the values and then our behavior.
It might make you cry.
It might make you cry, yeah. Yeah, so you mentioned powerful questions, and that's kind of good maybe to pick this up the next time. You can already remove those bricks to show kind of what those, you know, what might, you can imagine throwing those bricks through these doors, right? Sometimes it can be very annoying too, because, you know, people may feel like they're being played with asking these questions. Like you're just, you know, using a playbook here. You know, it feels inauthentic to ask these questions maybe. And that's something I'm struggling with still. Like, okay, I understand the value of answering these questions. I know how difficult it is to answer these questions. I know how hard it can be to be asked such a question. But how can you still authentically coach someone while using these questions, which are techniques, which are from a playbook, which may sound mechanical? So that's maybe something to think about before we pick it up next time.
Practice. Talking about practice.
So thanks for being here.
What, that one I'm hovering over it, why does it look like a chicken?
Does it look like a chicken?
Kind of does.
I don't know. I didn't know. What did you eat today, Scott?
Not enough, clearly.